Well, thank you, David, for speaking with me. I mean, obviously we spoke, you know, a few years ago, like maybe 2018 or 17, something like that. And obviously, you know, that was a pretty intense interview. A lot has happened since you've been on quite a journey since. So I'm happy to catch up with you. And, you know, we talked a lot about mental health last time, and your most recent album is actually called Therapy Sessions.
Yeah.
So I guess the obvious first question to start is, you know, why did you call it that? What's the significance to that title?
Yeah, well, I call it Therapy Sessions just because they were the songs that were coming out while I was going through therapy myself.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, a lot of this like frustration that was coming out that I had never, I guess, never allowed to come forward. And I was now finally being able to take a look at was coming through and being put into the songs, kind of like a way of completing my therapy in a way, just by like, just... what is it, verbalizing the frustration.
When you say not allowed, do you mean you were not allowing yourself, or was it an outside force that was not allowing it?
I was not allowing myself because I felt like I needed to be happy. I needed to be, you know, put a good face for everyone and a good front. And so I was like, oh, if I'm angry or upset or stressed and all that, then I'm being ungrateful and I'm not appreciating where I am and what everything that's happened to me in my life, you know, I need to be grateful for it. So, but I mean, a lot of it was relationship oriented as well, that I was frustrated. I was still not sure why I couldn't make relationships work and what was holding me back, and not just in like dating relationships and work relationships as well. I just was so good at getting in my own way, like self-sabotaging. And I just didn't understand why, but I kept doing it anyway.
So obviously recently you came out in June as LGBTQIA+. And we'll talk a little bit about that later, in the sense that most of the reaction was really positive, which actually made me feel really happy, because, you know, there are so many trolls online. But if there were trolls, they had more issue with the letters than anything else. But before we get into sort of that sort of thing, I guess the obvious first question is, what was it that made you finally want to do it on that day, in the way you did it, on social media? Like, was this a long time coming, or was it an impulsive thing where you just were like, all right, I'm just going to do this? Like, take me through the whole process of you deciding to do it.
That day that I decided to do it, it was a bit more impulsive. But I think it was definitely a process in the making, because I was in a relationship with someone and I just realized it wasn't going the way I was hoping it would again. Like, same thing always, it always repeats itself. I just didn't feel comfortable. I wanted to hide. I wanted to run away. And I wasn't sure why. I'd always been honest with whoever I was dating. Well, it was something I kept to myself as far as like not saying it to the public. I always let the people I know who are close to me and who I dated know that I didn't know, like that I might be gay.
Right.
At first. And then recently to just say like, you know, to just let them know I'm bisexual, mm-hmm. is what I've most recently come to. And so I was honest with this girl and she was cool with it and super patient, super loving, great girl. But I still couldn't feel good about, as it got more and more serious, I was just like, I can't do this.
Mm-hmm.
I was getting such bad anxiety. I feel like I needed to make room to really be honest with myself about my feelings. And I couldn't just say, yeah, they're there, but I'm just going to get rid of, like, act like they're not anymore. I had to be willing to let them remain up front and realize that this is something that I go through and I'm not going to be able to just push down, because it made me go insane. Like, it was making me very angry, very resentful. And I was feeling a lot of hate. I'm sure towards myself, but it was like overflowing onto the person I was trying to get into a relationship with.
Mm.
And when I realized that is not a healthy way to get not a healthy foundation to set a relationship on, I was just like, I went through this crisis where I'm like, I don't know what I do. What do I do? What I do? And I just realized I have to just be honest with myself, like, David, you might be more attracted to guys than girls, and you just need to accept that. And, you know, we took a break from dating, and she came over one day, and I was just like, you know what, I think I just have to be honest and say, I don't think this is going to work. And I might have to, like, I have to be honest and let these feelings come out up front so I can hold them in my hands without judging them, mm-hmm. so that I can stop judging myself so harshly. And she was so cool about it. I mean, she's just awesome. I still talk to her as like a friend, but just not as much as I did before, you know, but that kind of led to, I'm like, so what do I do now? I'm like, what do I do? And I kind of have like a faith crisis, because I'm like, what does this mean with my beliefs? Like, mm-hmm. my beliefs have always been so central, and now I don't know what to do with it. Cause I kind of felt like I had to choose one or the other. Like, if I want to accept more of this, then that means I have to like let go of my beliefs. Otherwise I'm going to hate myself even more. But then I like tried one more time to like pray it out. I'm like just praying and asking God, I'm like, God, if you are there and if you really have a plan for me and really like really, if like, I just, if I don't want this, I don't want to go through something you don't want for me. So please take this flaw from me. Please just take it from me so that I'm not living in a way that you wouldn't want me to. And it was like the first time in a long time that I heard him. And he just said, David, you need to stop asking me this. It was like so straight up and like so clear. And I was just like, what? And he said, he's like, I don't look at it the same way that you are looking at it. And he's like, you need to stop asking me to change something that I intended for you. Like, I created you this way, and now it's for you to understand why. And I was like, but this is not what I thought. I just was like, I didn't think this is how you looked at it. I thought this is something I need to overcome, and I need to like persevere through and like, you know, push aside and stuff. And because that's what I thought were his commandments and stuff. And he was just like, David, I don't look at it the same way as most people in church look at it. He's like, I know like there are people trying to follow me and stuff, but it's, you know, I think it's time for you to understand better how I see it. Wow. And I was like, what? I'm like, well, how do I do that? Like, I don't know. And he was like, well, he's like, David, perhaps you need to make what you think are mistakes. And it was just like, and so I was like, what I think are mistakes? I was like, that was very specific. So then I was like, well, what kind of mistakes should I make? Cause I was like, I kind of wanted to be like, I don't know. I didn't want to do anything wrong. And he's like, that's not right. He's like, as God, I don't tell you what mistakes to make. So he's like, that's for you to figure out. But he's like, you know what? I give you permission to make mistakes. So you're going to find out what you thought were mistakes and aren't. And also you'll make mistakes, but it's fine because I trust you. Like, I trust that you'll get back up and keep moving forward. And I know you trust me, David. So, you know, you'll figure it out. And so I was like, okay, well, fine. I'll do that. I guess that means just exploring my feelings that I have for whoever I'm attracted to. And if that's ends up being a mistake, well, at least I know I can make mistakes. And if it's not a mistake, then at least I got to learn that as well, and gave more compassion to myself to do that and not be so judgmental towards me. And so, that's kind of what led to it. And then I just was doing yard work outside like a few days later and pulling the weeds. And all of a sudden it was like, God just, he like came back like so clear again. And he just said, David, you know, I trust you, right? And I was like, well, yeah. Which it feels kind of weird to be like, yeah, you trust me. But I just like, it's like, yeah, I know you trust me. And he said, I want you to share what you've been going through right now. And I was like, okay. And it was like, I knew exactly what I needed to say. I just didn't feel comfortable talking about it. So I was like, oh, do I really have to talk? I'm like, maybe I should give myself a little more time. Like, but I was like, no, I'm just going to do it. So I did. And I talked about like, hey, so I posted that post, let people know my journey so far. And that I'm like, hey, there should be room to be able to still have a relationship with God, be a person of faith, but still also be honest with your sexuality and have room for that. And I don't have all the answers, but you know, maybe the more we talk about it, we can find better solutions. Cause I don't think we're there yet.
Yeah. So. I like this. I was going to say version, but I like this relationship that you have with God. It's a version of God that some people, this is not what they think God is or what God is saying you should do. You know, they have different, you know, and that's brings me to asking about, you know, obviously in the general world, this coming out post, yeah, was very well received by lots of people, but like in the Mormon community, how was it received? Cause there's different things. Like, I don't know if you know who Tyler Glenn is from Neon Trees. Mm-hmm. He came out not relatively recently, maybe like 3 or 4 years ago, and he was Mormon and he has left the church. But then there are other people like Dan Reynolds, who is not gay. I'm sure you know of the work he does with the Love Loud Foundation, who kind of has, he's the best.
And
he
kind of has,
yeah, they're so good. His Love Loud Foundation, I'm sure you're aware of this, but for people who, mm-hmm. you know, it's kind of more like the mentality you have, that like you can kind of maybe change that community from within. You don't have to leave it or disavow your faith or whatever, and also be gay or bisexual or LGBTQ+. So in general, like when you came out, how was it received within that community?
Well, I feel like I was just sincere. Like, I think people could tell from my community, they still could tell this is still important to me. Like my faith and what I grew up with, like this is what's shaped who I am and how I experience my world. Mm-hmm. And so I feel like they were really, I mean, just about everyone like was super supportive, which I wasn't expecting. Mm-hmm. I thought I was going to be told more like, I thought I was going to be quoted more scripture of like, oh, people trying to save me and all this stuff. And like, but it wasn't that. It was like very far and few in between. Maybe like some places, like people were like, well, why did he feel like he needed to talk about this? Why didn't he just keep it to himself? And why do people always feel like they need to say this and make a big deal about it? I'm like, well, and I mean, I didn't respond to them, but if I were to, I would just say, you know what, someone was saying even like, why, you know, what if kids are looking at this? And I was like, you know what, I wish when I was a little kid that there was someone talking about this, because I didn't understand what I was going through. I thought there was something wrong with me and I didn't know how to put it into words. I was 8, 9 years old and confused because I didn't know what it meant to have sexuality that wasn't just heterosexual.
Was that the age you were when you first had like kind of some feelings or some idea that maybe you were different from other people?
Yeah. I had my first feelings of attraction were towards girls, but then guys started falling after. And that's when I was really confused. I'm like, why do I feel this regardless of the gender? Like I was really uncomfortable because I didn't know what that meant. I didn't know what that was. And so it's just kind of like you spend the rest of your life just kind of keeping it alone and being confused about it and not knowing what to do. And so I was like, I just, you know, I think a lot of people who come from like, maybe if you do want to like be more, you know, reserved with your life and just keep it more conservative with how you go about discovering your attractions and your sexuality, even if it's that, I feel like, you know, there still should be room for people who are LGBTQIA+. Mm-hmm. And I like to add the Q and the I and the A just to help people know there's not just one normal way for everybody. Everyone has a unique experience, even a different spectrum of how much more attracted you might be to guys versus to girls, or you may not have as many sexual impulses like me. Like not everyone in my family, like we're all raised the same way, but I can tell you my siblings, there are some who are way higher sex drive than I do. And I just, at first I thought, again, I'm like, there must be something wrong with me, but it's like, you know what? It's just, some people just don't have those desires. They like to bond more on an emotional level than.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's a thing called demisexual. I'm sure you know that. Or yes. Sapiosexual. Yeah. I thought that was an important. I mean, as I was saying before, anyone who, there were some trolls or whatever who were sort of making fun of all the letters. Why are there so many letters? They keep adding letters, you know, A, B, C, D, E, F, G. But I thought it was important because I do think people tend to think like, okay, are you gay or straight? Like those are your two options, maybe bisexual, but you know, obviously there are more terms that have come out in recent years and some people don't kind of understand them, or they very much want you to put a label on a thing. Like, what are you? And I felt like your post basically showed like, first of all, it's okay to not totally be sure of that or still be figuring that out. But also it isn't just, you know, A, B, two options. You have multiple options. Like, I'd like to hear your thoughts on the fact that there are people that sort of like feel that sexuality needs to be labeled very specifically or put in a box. Are you, after having done this post, do you have a little more clarity about, I mean, not that you have any obligation to label yourself, but do you have a little more clarity about like defining your sexuality?
I mean, I kind of just like not having to define it because I feel like there's so many assumptions that go into a labeling yourself with one thing. And that's a problem with, you know, with how a lot of people from religious backgrounds, when they think of gay, they have so many assumptions that go with that. I was one of those people. That's why I couldn't accept myself because I'm like, I can't, no, that doesn't make sense for me. And I'm not, and it wasn't
like
until
you,
I read
like you
a book,
gotta pick a side.
Yeah, or just I have to identify a certain way, I guess, is, and I just, it wasn't until I read a book by this guy from my church named Charlie Bird, and it was a book called Without the Mask. He was the BYU University Cougar mascot. He was like the ESPN mascot of the year. He went viral with all these dances and like flips and stuff, and he came out as the mascot but also as gay. And he worded it in such a way that I was like, this is so important, because he knew how to talk to the conservative audience who was too afraid to have conversation about gay people or bisexual or any LGBTQ plus. He said, I'm gay. He said, the reason why I identify as gay, because a lot of people are like, oh my gosh. Because he said himself, he's like, people so many times think, in church, they think gay means sex. It means when I come out, it means I'm going to have sex with everybody every day now. He's like, that's not what it is. He's like, I just am drawn. I want to connect and bond with guys. He's like, you, just the way you like to bond with the opposite sex. And it doesn't mean you want to get in bed with them all the time, every second of the day. You just want to connect. You feel this attraction. You feel this bond. He's like, that's how it is for guys. He's like, and he's like, being gay, he's like, I also identify with gay because it's more than just who you are physically attracted to. He's like, I have an eye for design. I'm sensitive. I love to dance. He's like, all these things that people, oh, that's so gay. He's like, yeah, because I am gay. And that's awesome. I love that. Mm-hmm. I was just like, he was able to take ownership back of that title that usually people used in a way in religion, like as something as like, he was able to take back and add it, like say, like, this is a beautiful thing. What I always thought was wrong with me, he's like, I feel like are the gifts that God's given to me to have an eye for design, to be more sensitive, to have more artistic nature in my way of being, and including in my way of how I love to bond with other guys. And he's like, it's not always, it doesn't always mean you're becoming this hyper sex person. You know, that's, you know, there's so much more beauty than just that. Yeah, you can, I guess people can choose to be sexual as well with that, but you don't have to. That's not what it entails. And that gave me space to be like, oh, I was like, I relate so much to this. And the way he worded it makes me feel like I have room in this community. I can accept that I'm bisexual. And that's okay. And it's actually a good thing. And it's a beautiful thing. And so that opened up my eyes. And I was like, who else needs this message? Like, Charlie gave me that freedom to find a balance between two things that are important to him. I just want to keep passing it on to anyone who else might need it.
I was just going to ask if you have ever spoken with this, with Charlie, have you ever met him in person or had a chance to like tell him how this book changed your life, basically?
I DM'd him after after I read it, last year, like last summer, one of my friends gave it to me and I was like annoyed. I'm like, why are you giving me this book? Cause I was still having a hard time like coming to terms with that with myself. I'm like, why are you giving me this book? But it was so, I'm so glad that my friend gave it to me. And I as soon as I finished it, I DM'd him. I was like, hey, thank you so much. Like this was exactly what I needed. And since then, and since I came out with my post too, like I've messaged him again. I still need to talk to him in person and thank him personally, but I have let him know how grateful I am for him and just his honesty and his bravery to like be right smack dab in the middle of two worlds. That's kind of awkward, an awkward place to be in, LGBT and a Latter-day Saint.
So, you know, you said that like now you can kind of be that for other people. You can kind of carry this message forward, which I think is amazing. I assume you've gotten a lot of DMs or messages from people both went outside and within the church. Can you share any stories you've had about the feedback of how your coming out has helped people?
Yeah, I mean, when I had that, there are like hundreds and hundreds of DMs from people who came from similar backgrounds as me, whether it's from my church or another church. And they're just like, wow, I thought I was alone. Mm-hmm. And I'm so glad to see I'm not the only one. And, or just saying like, hey, I'm scared. I don't know who to talk to. Or they'd just be like, I've never told anyone this, but I think I am gay, or I think I'm bisexual, or I think I'm asexual. It was just kind of cool to give people a space to talk. And a lot of asexual people are like, wow, like, thank you for saying something. Cause we feel like they're like, we feel like we don't have a lot of representation for, and like, you know, but anyway, I think what was also cool is parents would DM me and they'd be like, my kid just came out to me last week, or they just came out to me this week. And we didn't know how to go about it, but just seeing your post gives us a little more peace of mind. Like it's not as foreign, as far away as we thought it was. Mm. And that's what I was hoping for, especially with like my own community. I was like, I want them to know this is close. It's not as foreign as they may look at it. Mm. One person says like, hey, my daughter came out to me as a lesbian and we didn't handle it well. And she's like, I wish I would have handled it better, but seeing your post makes me realize, you know, maybe I could go about this differently. And that's my goal. Like, I want more space for that, you know?
Wow. That's amazing. So it's a little bit of a loaded or a complex question, but I guess that's how all these questions have gone okay. I mentioned earlier that Tyler Glenn, using him as an example, musician from the Mormon community, came out as gay, and his conclusion was that he could not reconcile those two worlds. He no longer considers himself part of the church. He no longer is a Mormon. Then there are, you know, the Love Loud situation where like it's the idea that you don't have to choose between the two worlds. But I'm curious, you're in the middle now. I know it's all very new, but do you think you can reconcile the two worlds? I don't mean necessarily you, but just in general, like, do you think the church can evolve and there can be a place in the Mormon community for kids that are gay? Because there obviously are different schools of thought on it. Some people are much more black and white about it, but do you see that world, that community evolving, and because of people like yourself?
What I've seen is there's a lot of room for conversation right now. And I don't have the answers. I'm not a leader of my church. I'm just participate in it. But I've seen, I think it's definitely a good time now. Even just a few years ago, I don't think it was the right time. Mm. I feel like we're in a place where I think things like, you know, having Dan Reynolds do Love Loud that first year in Provo, Utah was a big deal. Like it just helped people who were afraid of this look at it hand on and still be uncomfortable And maybe they were still uncomfortable even after the event and going, but it still helped them look at it differently. And things like that, I think, need to happen before we can get somewhere else. And I don't know what that place is, but I've seen, like, even I've talked to even church leaders, like, who do make a lot of decisions. In the end, they do say, it's like, well, you know, it's like, we need to involve God and see how do we handle this and still, like, stand where he would want us to stand. But I mean, even the church leaders, when I would talk to them and say, you know, what if I, you know, if I start dating guys and stuff and they make a move on me and I don't refrain and I actually really enjoy it, like, what do I do? And they're just like, you know what, David, you need to not be so hard on yourself. And they're like, and I think even though they don't have all the answers, I think, you know, one of them just like, hey, well, just keep me posted. Keep me posted on what you learn. Hmm. And he's like, but don't be hard on yourself. He's like, you still go to church. You're still worthy to participate in everything that you're already doing. Like, you don't judge yourself before God judges. Cause that's what my problem was before. I was like saying, this is what God thinks. But then God was like, actually, no, be more compassionate towards yourself. So I think there's definitely, we just need to keep having conversations.
And your children's book, I mean, it's obviously open-ended. It could be, you know, anyone in any kind of situation could read it, but is it inspired by this? Cause like there's, you know, the whole, you know, kind of moral of that story is, oh, God had a plan for me all along.
Yeah. You know, the song, the book, I feel like there's a lot of similarities for sure. That's not the reason I released the book, but definitely to say we ask for things and we'll pray for things and say, God, can you help me with this? This is my request. This is what I'm asking. And he doesn't always answer how we want him to. And we can be really disappointed with how things turn out sometimes, but that doesn't mean that it's over. It doesn't mean that you can still find joy even after disappointment. And sometimes when you don't get the answer you were looking for, sometimes you can gain a whole new perspective and a better one. Just like me, like, for example, like I was trying to pray, God, please take away this flaw. And he didn't give me what I wanted, but what I wanted wasn't what I needed anyway. He wanted me to understand how he saw things better. And it ended up being all the better.
So when you had that, it's great. So when you know, going back to the beginning of this interview, you were dating a girl and, you know, you were feeling like it was not a good situation. And you had this conversation with God who advised you to make, and I'm doing this in air quotes, mistakes, because I don't think they're mistakes, but, you know, basically to take these risks. So, you know, I don't know if you want to talk about this, but have you, now that you're out and you've kind of had this epiphany, have you started either dating guys or at least kind of considering, like, dipping your toe in the dating pool and thinking like, okay, maybe I'm ready to give this a try?
Yeah, I feel like if I wanted to be honest with myself, and understand my feelings, I had to be open to that. And I definitely have my boundaries still, because I'm trying, you know, I like to be careful still, but, you know, I feel like I've had to be willing to get to know guys and know what it feels like, to understand what my feelings are and to understand myself better. So.
And it might be, I mean, it's an interesting situation to be in because, I mean, you know, since you're new to this world, you obviously have to pick guys to go out with who are understanding and very patient and sort of like, will let you like figure stuff out. But has that been something you've tried at all? Like, I'm not asking for like sordid details. Have you gone to dinner with anyone? You know,
it's been great so far. And I feel like, yeah, I feel like God has given me people that I needed to walk this journey with. And them with me. It's been really wonderful so far.
That's amazing. I'm so happy for you. What sort of, is this a future you ever envisioned for yourself? I mean, you're 30 now. Obviously you got into the public eye at a very young age and you were like this heartthrob with your song Crush. There were some girls on Twitter who, you know, in a joking way, were a little sad about your news. They're like, I thought David was singing Crush to me, which was cute. I think I might have retweeted that one. But, you know, when you look back at when, you know, you were on American Idol or when you were 8 and confused now you're 30 and like a whole new world is open to you. I mean, is this ever a future that you envision you could have for yourself?
I still don't know what my future is, but I'm not so judgmental to what the possibilities could be on that. You know, what confused me before I was afraid of. Now I'm just like, you know, I still don't understand this, but I'll figure it out. And, you know, I'm not afraid to wait it, you know, figure it out, go through it, move forward and see where it takes me instead of being like, you know, mm-hmm. It's just a different perspective on what I don't know. And just more open to what my options are now. You know, I have more options than I gave myself before.
Awesome. Well, the last question I'll ask you is for anyone who's checking out this interview and is grappling with their own decision to come out as you know, anything on the spectrum of LGBTQ+, whether they're Mormon or not, but especially if they have any kind of religious background, like what would be your advice to them if they're thinking about, you know, getting their phone and doing what you did and pressing, you know, publish, and they're kind of understandably freaking out? What would be your, cause you know, it's a big deal. What would be your advice to someone who's kind of at that crossroads?
Well, for me, I would say it wasn't just, okay, I'm just going to suddenly like post it all. It was a process. I found someone I could trust, someone who wasn't too close to me that I felt like could have an objective look on it. And, you know, I think if you feel it out, you'll feel a little bit of nerves, but you can tell when there's someone that you can confide in and open up to. But I would recommend it not be someone too close to you that you're seeing like, will they approve of me or not? I'd say find a safe place, and then it'll give you courage to be comfortable with yourself, to then have the harder conversations with the people who are closer that you don't know exactly how they'll respond, but it'll give you the confidence to work through it with them so that they can support you and understand where you're coming from and love you, even if they don't fully understand how it all works. And I think step by step, go easy on yourself, be compassionate. And don't try to, there's no need to rush it unless you feel like that's where you need to take it.
Was your family, I know you had said actually in your post that you initially came out to them as gay, I believe, right? Several years ago. And again, this is an evolving situation. When you went public with this, how was their reaction? Were they supportive?
They're super loving. I came out first to my mom and my younger sisters, and they didn't try to tell me anything. They just said, we love you. And they gave me a hug and that was it.
That's exactly the right thing to do.
Yeah, it was exactly what I needed. Cause I think sometimes you think, oh, how do I help them? What answer do I give them? And it's like, you don't need to, this is for them to figure out, you know, especially if you grew up all your life, you know, religious. And it's like, I already know, I've already been told like my whole life, I've already been told, like, we already know like how a lot of churches look at this and like what the opinion is on homosexuality and things. Like, you don't need to be told anymore. This is a very brave, courageous thing to say. I know, in spite of everything I've believed and been taught, I need to give myself room to understand this better. Because if not, it's driving me crazy and I need to not hate myself anymore and judge myself. So to say, you know, let them take that journey and just show love and walk with them as they find it. Even if you don't understand it all at first.
Well, I'm so glad that you're in a good place and that you're not judging yourself harshly. I'm so glad that, and I'm so happy for you. And I've really enjoyed speaking with you. Are there any, before I let you go, any kind of organizations that seems like very important for you to, as you say, kind of carry this message for? It could be Love Loud or it could be anything else. Are there any kind of LGBTQ+ organizations, youth organizations that you want to advocate for or mention or anything like that?
You know, I don't know, other than like, you know, the Trevor Project, I know is something that Dan has been involved with a lot as well. And so helping with, especially with like this suicide amongst teens who feel like that's the only solution to fix their brokenness is to take them away because they're not fixable. So I just say, be mindful of that. You know, a lot of teens don't want to feel what they're feeling, and they're afraid of what they're feeling, which is why they need more compassion. I feel like it's more important for them to live their life, even if you don't understand why they lived that life, than to have them gone. And you might be surprised at how beautiful their life can end up being just by allowing them to embrace that part of them.
Absolutely. Well, you are evidence that it does get better. So thank you for speaking with me. I really enjoyed it. I'm so happy for you. I'm so excited to see whatever happens for you next. And thank you for your time.
Thank you, Lindsay.